Bibliophiles of the internet. Today I'm here to share some random book recs based off weirdly specific vibes. Shout out to my friends in the CBPS for giving me this idea and for submitting their immaculate vibes. If this goes well, you have them to thank. I'm not even going to explain further, we're jumping right in with the first vibe, which is escaping from the capitalist hellscape. I had a few possible answers for this one. We're gonna start with Spellhacker by M.K. England. This is a genre-bending adventure that's both sci-fi and fantasy about a world where magic is known as Maz and is a tangible natural resource. There was a huge earthquake that unleashed a magical spell plague, and now Maz has become much more strictly regulated and gatekept by megacorporations, which is why Diz and her friends run a highly lucrative, highly illegal Maz siphoning business. They're actually getting ready to go their separate ways, and Diz figures taking on one last job would set them up pretty well and also allow them to potentially heal the rift growing between them. But they accidentally discover a powerful new strain of Maz that could very well change everything. I think this story is anti-capitalist in so many ways, primarily because it's about a small band of queer misfits with very specific skill sets who are breaking laws to secure these highly overpriced and otherwise inaccessible resources. So that's one way they're openly defying the rules of capitalism, but also their entire mission becomes about evading these greedy capitalist overlords who are hunting them down in hopes of securing and monopolizing this powerful new strain of Maz. They are the one thing standing between these megacorporations and complete control of the market, and by extension, all of humankind. They also realize that this form of Maz could be the key to understanding this mysterious spell plague and possibly saving the world. So the fact that they prioritize that over monetary gain is very anti-capitalist. On a very different note, the next place my brain went to was Dr. Robin Wall Kimmerer's Braiding Sweetgrass. This is nonfiction. It's a memoir and manifesto written by Dr. Kimmerer, who is a member of the Citizen Potawatomi Nation and also a very celebrated scientist. Specifically, she's a botanist, and this memoir explores the different functions, meanings, and uses of plants, especially in the context of environmentalism and the ever-present challenge of climate change. As I said, part of this book is exploring the author's own background and experiences, but it's also a very pointed attack on capitalism and market economy that not only invites us to think about how we can be more grounded and empathetic people within those systems, but how we can redefine our relationship with resources. It's about how practices of mindfulness, gratitude, and abundance mindset can get us so much further than falling into the trap of the scarcity mindset and the easy passivity of not caring where our resources come from or what kind of impact they have outside of ourselves. This book is also just a shining testimony to the indisputable fact that indigenous knowledge is science, and understanding the inherent truth of that statement is not only anti-colonial, but incredibly anti-capitalist. The last title my brain would not let go of for this vibe was Front Desk by Kelly Yang. I know I talk about these books all the time, but they are just that good. I'm kind of threading the needle a little bit closely with this one because it's about Mia Tang, who's a first-generation Chinese-American immigrant, and her parents manage a small motel in Anaheim. They're overworked, overwhelmed, and understaffed more often than not, so Mia helps them around the motel by running the front desk, and also making sure that the landlord doesn't find out that her parents help hide immigrants in the empty rooms at night. Like I said, this one's kind of playing both sides because, by definition, Mia and her parents are inherently part of a capitalist landscape, albeit not necessarily by choice. Operating a business is definitely a capitalist venture, but their mindsets and their business ethics are very anti-capitalist. More than anything else, they are huge proponents of building community and fostering mutual cooperation, which is a very anti-capitalist mindset. They do not play into those individualistic values of gaming the system or getting ahead for themselves. They really care about the people around them and do everything they can to help those people lead lives of dignity, health, and safety. Whether they're hosting free English classes, all-ages tutoring sessions, holding potlucks, organizing protests, helping people apply for jobs or assistance programs, whatever it may be, they're doing it themselves, on their own terms. Next, I thought I would put a twist on the first vibe and go with Escaping the Hellscape. Not gonna lie, I kind of wanted to do this one simply to once again recommend Hell Followed With Us by Andrew Joseph White. I know I made a very passionate case for this in my March wrap-up, but it's so incredible that I would be doing it a disservice by only talking about it once. This is a post-apocalyptic dystopian horror story about a trans boy named Benji who's desperately trying to escape this religious extremist cult. This cult is basically responsible for bringing about the end of the world because they believe their faith is telling them to purge the world of corrupt non-believers and start over again with a quote-unquote clean slate. So they've developed a virus known as the Flood, which kills off these so-called non-believers, but they've also done some human experimentation to transform some of the faithful into monsters known as Graces, which they can weaponize to continue their purge. Not only that, but they've developed an even more powerful serum that can turn people into seraphs, which can in turn control the Graces, and also they contain the power to wipe out the rest of the human race. Benji is a seraph, created with the sole purpose of helping this cult finish what it started, but he is terrified and does not want them to have that kind of power, so he runs away and is taken in by this ragtag group of queer teens who are just fighting to survive. This story is absolutely horrific in the best possible way. Very graphic, very bloody, lots of body horror, lots of content warnings. Those are included in all of my reviews for this book, and they will also be included down below, so please do carefully consider those. The best word I can apply to this book is cathartic. It's full of fury and rage, fear, brutality, and violence, but it's about a trans hero who is fighting his way through all of those things. I mean, if you want to talk about a trans boy fighting with everything he has to survive a deeply horrific, deeply flawed, deeply unsafe world, there is no book that better uses fantasy and horror to highlight that gruesome reality than this. I've said it before, but this book is about becoming the monster. It's about becoming the weapon when everyone already tries to weaponize your entire existence. It's about taking the way people have been taught to fear and hate you and turning that fear into a prophecy, into a consequence. This is a dystopic story that says, oh, you want to believe that trans people are something to be feared? Then maybe I'll give you something to be scared about. This is literally a story about queer teens fighting their way through the worst kind of hell, refusing to give up and knowing that they won't come out the other side unscathed, but they still advance towards that future regardless. I have to stop myself there, but please, please read this book. The other title that came to mind for this vibe was The Ones We're Meant to Find by Joan He. It's a futuristic dystopian story, which I think is like the techno-aesthetic of Want by Cindy Pond meets the raised virtual wasteland of Ready Player One, but while actually taking the long-term consequences of climate change into account. For the record, that's also something that Want by Cindy Pond does. It's about this 16-year-old STEM prodigy, Casey Mizuhara, who lives in this eco-city built for the mega-rich, where most people spend a majority of their time in virtual reality and stasis pods. Casey, who's naturally introverted and also functioning on a level that most people don't understand, doesn't actually mind having to do that, but she's discontent because her much more adventurous sister Celia tries to escape by going out to sea and then mysteriously disappears. Now C has been trapped on a very mysterious abandoned island for many years with no recollection of who she is or how she got there, and the story is basically about these sisters trying to make their way back to each other no matter what. I really like this book. It's original, it's unexpected, it's high concept and high octane with like 10,000 game-changing plot twists, and it's a reading experience I haven't quite been able to shake. I think both these characters are definitely fighting to escape the hellscape in their own ways, whether it's Casey trying to use her access, privilege, and knowledge to help humankind break free of this societal techno-prison, or C trying to figure out who she is and how to escape this island that seems endless. It's really fascinating to see how these characters are connected and the ways they both continue to shape each other, even in their absence. They're both incredibly strong-willed characters fighting to survive in an environmentally and technologically hostile world, so I think this book definitely fits the prompt. The next vibe is makes you want a snack. I love this vibe, I could make entire videos out of it, but there were two titles that came to the forefront, and the first is American Dreamer by Adriana Herrera. It's a queer adult contemporary romance about Nesto, an Afro-Dominican chef and entrepreneur who owns and operates his own food truck. He dreams of opening a brick-and-mortar restaurant, and in pursuit of that dream, he decides to move away from his friends, his family, and the only home he's ever known to really kickstart his business. He's also given himself a very strict deadline of 6 months, and if he's not turning a profit within that time, then he's sworn to go back to the desk job that he absolutely despises. One of his daily stops in his food truck is outside the local library, where he meets the perfect distraction in the form of Jude Fuller, a passionate librarian and food enthusiast who quickly makes Nesto's truck a regular lunch spot for completely innocuous reasons. This story doesn't do anything by halves. It's super queer, it's incredibly romantic, and it goes all in on those delicious food descriptions every single time. Nesto is extremely passionate about the food he makes, why he cooks, who he cooks for, and there's so much detail that goes into planning his menus every single week. Not only that, but cooking is the way he shows care and expresses love, so food is very much a part of this book's genetic blueprints. Do not read this book on an empty stomach. It will leave you wanting to eat Nesto's food because you can tell just based on description alone that it's absolutely delicious. The other title I thought of for this was A Taste for Love by Jennifer Yen. This YA romance is pitched as Pride and Prejudice meets the Great British Bake Off, but with a Taiwanese twist, and I can say with confidence that this is entirely the case. Liza has spent her entire life growing up in her parents' combination bakery restaurant, but sadly she and her mom don't really see eye to eye when it comes to her dating prospects. So her mom ends up forcing her to help judge and run the bakery's annual junior baking contest, but what she doesn't tell Liza is that all the contestants are nice young Taiwanese boys that her mom has hand-chosen for her to date. I've said it before, but when you cite the Great British Bake Off as one of your comp titles, that is a very big promise to make, and it's a standard that this story meets beautifully. Liza is an experienced, accomplished baker, and there is so much detail put into showing her baking process. This story goes all in when it comes to the baking competition and how much care Liza puts not only into judging, but also creating and testing her own recipes. And I also love how everything regarding cooking and baking is not whitewashed in this story. Liza and her family are Taiwanese American, and the culturally specific ways in which they view food, make food, and eat food is also a huge narrative centerpiece. My last vibe for the day is, I'm sorry ma'am, I just work here. The first title I immediately thought of was Phoenix Extravagant by Yoon Ha Lee. This book does not get nearly as much love as it deserves. It's an extremely unique queer sci-fi fantasy story about Gyeon Jebi, a non-binary artist whose main character trait is being a known pacifist and who literally only wants to paint. Even though they're jobless and they have no prospects and no future, they refuse to do anything else. However, they somehow find themselves recruited by the military to paint the mystic sigils that animate the government's automaton soldiers and creatures. But when Gyeon discovers the depths of the government's crimes and the horrific origin of the mystical pigments they're using to paint these sigils, they realize that they might not actually be able to stay out of politics. I think this book perfectly fits this vibe because Gyeon Jebi is the textbook definition of a reluctant hero. They don't even want to work, much less get involved in the military or in politics. Their ideal version of their life is one where they could just paint and exist. But then they suddenly find themselves with all this high-grade military access. So Gyeon is basically moved to action not because they really believe in doing the right thing, but because they discover these dangerous secrets that need to be exposed, and they just happen to be the only person who can do it. When they first take on this job, they're definitely of the mindset that it's just a professional excuse to paint. They paint, they get paid, they don't actually have to do anything difficult, but then they find themselves roped into this bigger adventure with far greater consequences. I just feel like if you went up to Gyeon Jebi at the beginning of this story and asked them literally anything, they would fully reply, I'm so sorry, I don't even want to be here right now. The second book that came to mind was Untamed Shore by Silvia Moreno Garcia. I think this is one of her more underrated books. It's historical and a mixture of mystery thriller noir set in Mexico, and it follows a young girl named Viridiana who is incredibly bored of her seaside town and dreams of Hollywood glamour and romance. When three wealthy American tourists arrive in town, she finds herself drawn into their circle when one of them hires her to be a note taker and personal assistant. She quickly gets suckered into running their errands, carrying their things, and even cooking their meals. But when one of them is killed, Viridiana suddenly finds herself cast in suspicion, and she's also expected to lie to protect her new quote-unquote friends. This is a really great mystery, in my opinion. It has a similar vibe to Knives Out, but obviously it's a bit different because it's grounded in a very distinctly Mexican perspective, and it openly interrogates the weaponization of whiteness. I think this story has big, ma'am, I just work here vibes because the main character is literally working for these American tourists, even being openly exploited by them, and she somehow gets drawn into this murder case. She's put in a really crappy position just because she was in the wrong place at the wrong time, associating with the wrong people. She gets screwed over because she was trying to approximate herself to whiteness and just make a few extra bucks. Getting roped into a murder case as a potential suspect or witness and being expected to lie for white people just because you were trying to make a little extra bank and change things up a bit definitely feels very, ma'am, I just work here to me, and I also just think it's a worthwhile story that more people should read. So those are my vibey book recs for today. I do have some leftover vibes that my friend suggested, but if you enjoyed this and want to see some more, feel free to drop some of your own vibes in the comments, and feel free to recommend any books that you thought of based on these vibes. But that's everything I had to share with you for today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.